mentioned the sal-in, where, of course, public officials reveal or state just how much they're worth. Now, you, in 2014, you are the ninth richest politician in the Philippines with declared assets of 474 million pesos and zero liabilities. Mm-hmm. How did you get this rich?
Well, I was a lawyer before I became a congressman. I still am. And I was in the corporate world. I was able to rise up the ranks of some corporate boards. I even ended up becoming the chairman of Equitable Banking Corporation and the chairman of Barangay Banking Corporation, the oldest mining corporation in the Philippines. And we were behind some of the biggest mergers in the country. So, well, we were very lucky and fortunate to make the right investments and decisions then.
Yeah. Who has zero liabilities in government? Only you. Huh? All right. Okay.
I'm old-fashioned. You know, my father never wanted to have utang.
Okay. Now, speaking of your father, I know he's passed away, but at one point, he was recognized by Forbes as the 30th richest man in the Philippines with a net worth of 3.3 billion pesos. Would you agree to that?
Well, I guess that's per their records, and I don't know how they come to that, but then again, I'm not going to contest anything because that's what they put out.
Now, would you consider your father a Marcos crony or someone who has benefited from the dictatorship or leadership of Marcos, him being the brother of Imelda Marcos?
He wasn't a crony. He was the brother-in-law of President Marcos. He was a governor for about 20 years, and he served as
But where would he get $3.3 billion? I mean, in net worth, where would someone in government get $3.3 billion?
I guess he had some investments as well. I was much younger then, so I didn't know his business transactions. But then again, there have been cases, and all of these cases revolving the PCGD and the anti-graft, most of them have already been dismissed, particularly the anti-graft cases. So the records speak for themselves, and I guess Forbes wouldn't come out with those figures if... they were derived from spurious sources.
Yeah. Do you think any of your father's wealth was illegally acquired?
No, I don't think so.
You don't think so. All right, I'm going to, since you mentioned the PCGG, I'm going to go on to read this. In 1986, after Marcos fled, the PCGG listed at least 61 corporations where your father was said to have acquired shares illegally. Now, you may be asking, this is the same Bongbong Marcos question. Okay. Why are you asking Bongbong Marcos about issues related to his father? Mm-hmm. Well, of course, because when you get into a national post, decisions you make, this is what the taxpayer believes, eventually affect, of course, your whole family.
Yes.
All right? So I want to ask you, all right, Benguet Corporation was mentioned, First Philippine Holdings, Mantrade then, part of Meralco, Shell, PCI Bank, among others. So if I were going to ask you today, your brother, you had mentioned, is still a shareholder of Benguet Corp.
Yes, he's a member of the board. Yeah, okay. Members of the board.
How did your family get into Benguet Corp?
Well, I believe these were investments made earlier on. And as I said, if there were any criticisms or accusations with respect to the provenance of these assets, they were all basically dismissed. And they were cleared, so everything's good.
Mm-hmm. All right. So, you know, during the time of Marcos and even Cory Aquino, the Romualdezes, in a sense, were low-key in terms of national public service. Now that you're getting into the national limelight, are you prepared for all these documents and accusations to be dug up once again? I mean, it's not easy being a Romualdez in public office.
Well, what is? Nothing in life is really that easy. But then, of course, we're ready because there's nothing to hide. We're very transparent about it. And I'm for the FOI. Mm-hmm. I'm all for presenting my statements of assets and liabilities to the public. We were actually one of the first to do that in the 14th Congress. Mm-hmm. And so we're ready for it. And it's just, as they say, par for the course. When you put yourself here in the national consciousness, then obviously you should be ready for all the criticisms and whatever accusations, and you've got to discharge yourself accordingly. And we've got nothing to hide, so we put ourselves there. But at the end of the day, we're here for a higher purpose, and that's to bring back, as I say, malasakit to the government. Mm. And we have a duty, we have a job to help our region. It's very, very easy to retreat back into the private sector, to be anonymous, just to do your own thing. Mm. But I cannot turn my back on the people in our region who suffered so much and who needs so much more help. I can only do so much from my private sector position, but I think I can do so much more. As a senator, the most important role is legislation. And Karen, the most important piece of legislation is the budget.
Okay, before we go to the budget, I'm gonna finish this part first.
Sure.
And then we're gonna move on to issues, the budget, your advocacy. Do you remember when you first got into the national consciousness?
My goodness,
you
should tell me.
I remember. You first got into the national consciousness as Martin Romualdez, as Congressman Martin Romualdez, when you were named, this could bring back bad memories, as the host of President Arroyo's dinner in Le Cirque.
Okay.
Where you allegedly paid $20,000 for dinner.
Okay.
Did you pay $20,000 for dinner?
No, I didn't pay for a $20,000 dinner, and I think that's all I can say about that.
You didn't pay for that, but then if you look at the old articles, is Malacanang had said you hosted and paid for it.
I can't say I have, because I didn't.
So who paid for that dinner? Because
really,
if you Google Martin Romualdez and Le Cirque, it will say that you paid for that dinner. I mean it.
Well,
so you didn't pay for it.
No.
You're on the record, huh?
Yes.
You're
yes.
on air.
I'm on air. I don't even know how much that dinner was. I was there, but I did pay for it.
So who paid for the dinner?
I don't know.
Yeah.
I didn't pay for it.
But didn't you stand up for that dinner at one point? When GMA was being hit, didn't you come out in an interview and say you hosted it? Never.
No.
You never did.
No.